So what I would like to come back is I would like to come back to what we discussed about polymers last time, and mainly we finished the lecture by saying that the chains are usually coils, except in some very particular situation where they can be seen as rods. And I said that what we would like to do today is mainly trying to understand a little bit more about the conformation of these chains. So let's do that. And if we try to do that, what we want to do is mainly look at the conformation of a polymer chain. Well, if we said last time that a polymer is made of an assembly of monomers, the easiest way to describe a polymer will be to say, well, we start from one point and we have all the monomers. Like that. All the monomers have a size A. And we assume simply that, well, the end-to-end vector the end-to-end vector can be looked at the sum of all the elementary monomers U1, U2, and so on. So we'll say simply that the average end-to-end vector, the end-to-end vector is the sum over all the monomers, so from E equal 1 to N of the UI vector. Well, if we assume that the polymer can be described something like that, it will be easy to see that if there are no correlations among the monomers, the average size defined as the average vector R is equal to zero. So we cannot use simply the end-to-end vector as a good description of the, in order to get an idea of what is the size of the polymer. And so this is due to the fact that we neglect the correlation. So I know that last week with Alessandro, you discussed polymer chains, but with another description. So instead of using this end-to-end vector, what people are using usually is that they are using R square in average. So, and then what we will say is that we will be able to characterize the size of a polymer by using this quantity. So this quantity allows to characterize the size of a polymer chain much better than the average value of the vector. So if we do that, we can say that the R square value is simply, well, it is simply the scalar of the UI vector times the scalar, the sum of the UG vector. And if we do that, it is simply the sum over this quantity, which is plus the sum over all the UE UG vector. So we sum, sorry. I will try to write it properly. So we sum over E and then we sum over G different to E. So it's a double sum. Okay with that? I mean, I'm sure that you have already seen this kind of calculation. And based on that, what we want to calculate is we want to calculate the average. And again, if here the question is on what do I am I making an average? So I would say that the average is either an average of all the different polymers or an average among times. I assume that, well, due to ergodicity, it will be the same. Well, if I do that, you probably already have written the results. So here, the first term is simply n, the number of monomer times a square, and the second term will be equal to zero because the second term is simply the characteristic of the fact that there is, I mean, the average of the second terms just says that there is no correlations among all the vectors. So this term is equal to zero. Well, this is an interesting result, which is that the size of the chain, that's, well, my stone, which is just making my phone falling on the floor. Bye-bye, Luca. And this size that I will write it R naught is simply the scale of a monomer times n to the power 1/2. So this is an important result, which shows that in average, a polymer chain is Gaussian. And the fact that a polymer chain is Gaussian, it has a very it has a lot of important consequences from the point of view of polymer. Sorry, why does it write next to the framed here? Anna, what is not clear here?
Hi, sorry, this first R, second row.
No correlations.
Okay, thank you.
Nice. Thanks, Jean. Yeah, do not hesitate to ask like that. So there are some really important consequences due to the fact that the polymer chain is Gaussian. The first thing is that, well, the size R0 is much smaller than the total length of the polymer, because n to the power 1/2 a is much smaller than n a. And from a practical point of view, it makes that polymers are really stretchable objects. Another very interesting characteristics of the polymers is that we can calculate, we can compare two things. The first thing that we can calculate is the volume of the polymer chains. And the volume of the polymer chains is of the order of R0 to the power 3, which is n to the power 3/3 times A3. And we can compare this volume to the volume of the monomers of one chain. And this volume is simply n times A3. So from that, we can calculate the number of chains in one chain. So which is that here to make it clearer. This is the volume R0 to the square, but there are some different chains inside. And we can calculate how many of them. Well, it's simply n to the power 3. Divided by n a square, which is the square root of n. Which means that within one chain, there are a lot of chains which are mixed. And one of the consequences of that is that the physics of polymer is a physics where entanglements will play a great role. And that's really a key feature of polymer physics. If we really want to understand some of the properties, such as their viscoelastic properties, everything is due to the fact that all these polymer chains, they are completely mixed due to their long size, and this will give rise to all the interesting properties of the polymer chains. Well, based on that, we can complicated a little bit the description of a polymer chain, and I don't want to spend too much time on that today, but we can go up to the Kratky-Porro model. Well, what is the Kratky-Porro model? It is, well, up to now, we have considered that the polymer chains, they are completely flexible. We have neglected that, well, the bonds, you cannot make them turn as you want. So in many polymers, we can say that the bonds between two monomers. Well, which means that if I look between one monomer UY and I look at the next monomer, usually due to the hybridization of the carbons, there is a fixed angle here. Which means that the next monomer will only be able to move among a cone. And the question is, well, does the Gaussian nature of the polymer, is the Gaussian nature of the polymer affected by that? To see that, we can try to write the mass of this correlation, and a good way of writing the mass is to say, well, if you assume that there is a correlation, we will simply say that, well, between a monomer and the one before, in average, There is an angle. And if we write something like that, we'll be able to say that if we look not between two adjacent monomers, but if you look after K monomers, then we'll be able to say that the correlation between one monomer and the one which is K after it will be of the same order of magnitude, and there will be a cosine of theta to the power k. So these you can look to be sure of that. And if we write something like that, and if we assume that theta is smaller than one, we will be able to rewrite this correlation in another form, and we will be able to say that, well, this will be a square times 1 minus theta square over 2 to the power k. So let's say that it's not equal, which is a square times 1 minus k theta 2, like that. And if we assume something like that, we'll be able to say that more or less another way of writing that is to say that the in average the between two angles between two monomers, we will be able to rewrite something like a square minus k a over LP if we define what I've written LP as A over theta square. So what can we tell from that? How will you interpret these? Any idea? Let's try. LP is equal to 2A over, yes. Yes. Sure. Yeah, I think that the question, we have a correlation length, which means the total length is bigger. You're right. So that I write. But I think that another thing that we could say from that is that in average, the chains will st the in average the chains the chain will still be Gaussian, which means that if we don't look at details smaller than these correlation lengths, well, which it means that at distances larger than that, the chain will forget that the monomers are more or less aligned, which means that if we renormalize the monomer chains by segment of size LP, we will say that, well, in average, the size of the chain will be kind of a Gaussian chain with a Kuhn segment, which is the kind of roads of size, of course, now larger than A, but which represents the size LP. Do you agree with this description of a polymer? So the idea is now, the polymer is still Gaussian, but we have to kind of renormalize the size of the monomers by saying that a polymer chain is a random walk of elements. Of size LP. By the way, it's U E plus K U E. Thanks. Okay, so which says that if we take into account the chain conformation, mainly it doesn't change the intrinsic nature of a polymer chain, which means that all what we have said before or what has been said with Alessandro in tutorials is still valid. Okay, so. Polymer chains are Gaussian. It's an important information. Well, I think that since I'm an experimentalist, I would be interested to measure that. Well, the length will not be the well, what we will say is that we have to define NP, which is the number of monomers in LP. So it's LP over A is NP. And then the size of the monomer, the size would be NP to the one. It would be something like that. So it's not exactly. Sorry with that. LP. No. I have to say that NA over LP gives NP, and then R naught is the square root of NP times A. So you'll see that at the end, you still have R naught proportional to N to the square root of N. Sorry with that. So, well, I must say that I think that I have some data here. That I can, I can calculate LP over A, which is the number of monomers within LP. And well, I have some data. LP over A is of the order of two for a polymer like PEO, which means that this one, polyoxyethylene, this one is really flexible. Whereas, what kind of data do I have? LP over A is of the order of five for the polystyrene. And if we go to other polymer, we can go to LP over A is of the order of 26 for the cellulose. And for very stiff polymer, like DNA, we'll have something like 300. So this one is really stiff. But anyway, from a practical point of view, this description of a random walk for a polymer should be valid. Well, now the question for me, since I am an experimentalist, is how will you measure that? I let you think about that. You have a sample where you have your polymers. Well, the size here. Like that. Well, if we say that it's 10 to the power 4 times A, let's say 0.5 a nanometer, it will be 100 times 0.5 nanometers. It will be 50 nanometers. Okay, that's a good order of magnitude for a size of a monomer. Oops. Optical tweezers. I mean, yeah, you probably have seen that with Alessandro. Optical tweezers will be perfect for DNA. And it's even better because DNA is so big that we will be able to see it with a microscope. Well, this won't work for polystyrene or PU or PDMS, which are more classical polymers. Any idea? Ah, sorry. What does a polymer, what does it exactly mean for the polymer to be Gaussian? It means that, I mean, it's more related to it is the fact that if we think that the polymer is more or less like a random walk, the probability of being at a distance or from the beginning will decrease like a Gaussian with respect to the initial position. Does that answer to your question, Audran? No, Abir. Sorry.
Okay.
Thanks. So, any other techniques? You love mass, but when it's a question to how can we measure it, it's much more difficult. So, no, sorry for making fun of you. The way people have done that is to use neutron scattering. And if I think I have prepared a picture with that. So it's I will send you these. So that's a nice paper. That's a paper that has been done by Coton and De Cloiseau. That almost all these papers in this are famous. So that's a paper on 1974. So it was the first paper where it was really possible to prove the shape of a polymer. So the idea is that, well, what you want to do is diffraction. You want to send a laser in a sample, and you want to see the diffraction, and the diffraction will be a signature of the shape of your object. Okay, exactly like you have done in lab experiments, where you put some lights in a powder, like in Lycopod, you will see the figure of diffraction, and the figure of diffraction will be the signature of the size of all the diffracting objects. So what you want is to shine light on a sample with kind of light which has a wavelength which is of the same order than the objects that you want to probe. So here we are dealing with objects which are 50 nanometers. So you cannot send light. You have to send something which is smaller length scale, which is smaller wavelengths. Well, if we want to go to small wavelengths, we have two techniques that are available. We have X-rays and neutron scattering. Okay, so the question is here, why is that usually not possible to use X-rays in this kind of experiments? Do you know why we need neutrons?
Because they are uncharged and they cannot perturb the, they cannot give electromagnetic perturbation to the chain.
Well, I guess. It's not really a question of being uncharged. It's a question of, I mean, François, you said polymers are uncharged. Am I right?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it's not only a question of that. I mean, sorry for writing that. It's a question that it's, so X-rays that interact with the electrons. That you are right. But the point is that the classical polymers we are using is that polymers, they have a number of electrons which is too small. Which makes that usually, well, the intensity of the diffracted X-rays is too small. So which means that X-rays are really good to work with metals as an example. That becomes a little bit less efficient with carbon or hydrogen. Of course, now due to sources like ESRF or Soleil, it's possible to work with X-rays of carbon, but at this time in 1974, it was more likely impossible to properly measure the diffraction due to one chain with X-rays. So instead of that, people used neutrons, So neutrons, they do not interact with the electrons. They interact with the nucleus. And what is interesting with neutrons is that since they interact with the nucleus, they can have a very nice opportunity with neutrons is the fact that you can use hydrogen or deuterium and they diffract neutrons differently. Which means that it's really nice because if you want, what you can do is you can make a sample. Made of, sorry with that. Made of polymers where the hydrogens are real hydrogens, and you can put in that some deuterated polymers. So doing that, if the concentration of the deuterated polymers is small enough, what you will have is clearly you will have these objects, they will be really independent, and you will be really in the situation where you see these objects in the other situation. And it's exactly what has been done in this paper. And of course, Julien, you were right, sometimes X-rays are too energetic also. That's the point. What do I mean by deuterated polymers? I mean that, well, like let's say polyethylene, it will be this is the polyethylene, and if I replace the hydrogen by deuterium, so here D is simply deuterium, this is a deuterated polymer. And they, and due to the fact that the neutrons will see differently the hydrogenated or the deuterated polymers, so you will be able to see the deuterated polymers in the system. So that's a very nice technique, and it's really often used in polymer physics or in soft matter. And friends, well, people in France were kind of the first expert in the world doing this kind of experiments in the 70s. And here you see the first data. So here it's R W to the square, which is more or less what I would have called R naught, which is exactly what is given by the diffraction pattern. And MW is the mass, so this is proportional to R naught to the power 1 to the power 2 divided by N. And here you see that it's almost a constant, which is a signature of what we said before, which is the fact that the polymer chain is Gaussian. So So I will send you this picture. And here again, you have the mass of the polymer change, which is proportional to the number of monomers. Okay, so it was really possible to precisely characterize the chain of the polymer by using neutron scattering, which is kind of a nice technique. So it's possible to use neutron scattering to characterize this. And then I would like to discuss a little bit kind of a paradox that I will call two four. And the question is kind of the paradox of the Gaussian chain. Well, up to now, what we have said is that, well, we have said that the size of a polymer should be n to the power 1 half times a. That's the Gaussian chain for random walk. And if we assume a random walk, like we have done before, well, this will be true if we think in terms of displacement in 1D, in 2D, in 3D, and so on. Well, it's probably so there is a problem that we have not dealt with before, is that we have taken into account the size of the angle between two monomers, but what about what we could call the steric exclusion? Which means that if we come back to what we had in mind, when we describe a polymer chain like that, well, here we authorize two monomers to be at the same place. So the random walk we have described up to now is not self-avoiding. And of course, the question of the fact that the two monomers shouldn't be at the same place should change a little bit the description of the self-avoiding walk. As an example, in 1D, well, if we think in terms of a random walk within 1D, there is no choice. The size of a self-avoiding walk in 1D is n times a. And if we look at the size of the size of the self-avoiding walk within 3D, well, it's not that easy. So for the random walk, that's easy. For the self-avoiding random walk, it's much more difficult. So you can perform numerical simulations. You can write that in Python if you want. And you can show that the size of a self-avoiding random walk will be more or less n to the power 3.5. Times A. So these will be the size of the chain where we consider what is usually called in the polymer community the excluded volume effect. You see that, well, when before we take into account the finite angle, the finite angle between two polymers, where is that? It didn't change the scaling, but now if we go to steric exclusion, it changes the scaling a lot. And of course, as we could have expected before, I mean, the size is much larger. So, do you see where is the paradox? And I think it's important to speak a little bit about that, because I'm sure that in the past, at least in StatFish courses, or I mean, even in tutorials with Alessandro, well, we always describe a chain which is individual, and we say, well, that's a random walk, and then we use all the tricks of StatFish to calculate the probability of being in one place or something like that. We will have all this Gaussian distribution, and if we say, okay, don't come back to the basis, all the monomers have the same size, all the monomers have a finite volume. Well, the polymer stretching much higher, and the Gaussian description should be not valid. I will come back to the question of and I come back on that. I let you think about this change. Yes, sorry for that. So I will answer to the question of Anna. So the MW is the molecular weight of the polymer chains. So if the chain is monodisperse, it's simply N times the molar mass of a monomer. In gram per mole. And well, so that is the definition when it's something like that, but it's more, I mean, to be more honest, the molecular weight of a polymer, usually they are not monodisperse, that's not simply one monomer size, so it will be the average over all the chains present, so ME divided by where NE is the number of chains. Having a molecular weight, maybe. Okay, Anna. Sorry for that. So I come back here about this scaling. So do you see the paradox, at least? Well, at least I hope that you see that this does not correspond of the experiment to the experiment. And indeed, what it tells is that there is something subtle in the polymer physics, which is that there are two effects. Of course, there is always a self-avoiding effect. Which exists. And in the same time, there are some van der Waals interactions between the monomers. And at the end, this council, in a very nice way, it's kind of a magic effect. And everything happens exactly if there wouldn't be any self-avoiding effect, or exactly if there wouldn't be any attraction between the monomers. But it's not trivial at all. I mean, if we think about it, I mean, usually we always describe the polymer chains as a random walk, but I think that we should think about the fact that the steric exclusion should be taken into account, and it will drastically change the scaling. And of course, I mean, this will be true if we deal with polymers in the melt, but it will be really different if some polymers are in solutions, because if we deal with polymer in solutions, well, then the constellation between the van der Waals, there will be a solvent, and the presence of the solvent will possibly change the scaling. So the idea is that usually polymers are Gaussian only when they are in a molten state. Okay. So with that, I finished what I wanted to say today about the polymer, and I would like to go to kind of lecture two, which will deal with the second lecture. I mean, as I said before, the lecture will not be always two hours, and the second lectures will be about fluctuating charges. So up to now, we haven't spent that much, I mean, about charges, except in dipoles, but today, what's in the second part of the lecture, I would love to discuss a little bit more about fluctuating charges. And the situation that I would like to discuss today, and probably the next time, is what is the situation of the charges close to a surface. So the question is the charge concentration And there are a lot of situations which are of interest like that, because well, what kind of charge surface do you know that could more or less relate to soft matter? Do you have any example where you have a surface which is charged, and of course, to some point, it will act as a condensator, but related to soft matter. Yes, you're right. So surfactant should be well, let's come back to something seen with David. If we deal with soap films, well, usually you have some polymers, some surfactants in the box also. And you have also some micelles. But usually, yes. Surfactants are often charged molecules. And of course, yes. So here, what will be the, well, here if we use SDS, then the charge of the molecule will be negative. You say the cell membrane. So what will be the charge of a cell membrane? Will it be positive or negative? Positive, negative, you know. Positive. Positive? No, the cell membrane is negative. The cell membrane. Yes, right. no, but you have. You have one reason for knowing that it's not it's not positive. I don't know if you have looked at the, if you buy some detergent, they always say that there is not that many cationic surfactants. Usually, they say that there shouldn't be more than 5% of cationic surfactants. And the reason for that is that if you have these cationic surfactants, they will strongly interact with the cell membrane. And since they will interact with the cell membrane, they are really bad for the environment. Any other example? Well, silica. Glass. As an example, on silica, usually you have SEOH. SEOH. And depending on the pH, all these guys, they can move, making some H+ ions. And by doing that, you will recover. A negatively charged surface. And well, in all these systems, so here again, you will have a negatively charged surface. So we can calculate kind of what will be the surface charge of a surface. Well, it will be of the order of minus 10 to the power 19 divided by an area, let's say 10 to the minus, what did I, 10 to the minus, sorry, 18. If we say one charge each nanometer square, and then it gives something like minus 20 millicoulomb per square meter. So this gives an order of magnitude of the surface charge that are important in soft matter. Because usually it's something, it's what we have or what is important for us. And the idea is, well, the idea of this lecture is to look at what is the distribution of, I mean, usually you have this surface charge, you put it in contact, well, let's explain a little bit what I want to do. And that DNA is negatively charged. So, well, the main kind of systems that we have seen is systems where the density of charge is negative. The idea is if I put in front of that a salt, let's say an electrolyte, what will happen? So how will be the distribution of charge regarding to this surface? That's the first question. And the second question that I would like to deal with is, well, now if I put two surfaces, in front of each other, how will they interact? Because that's really important in soft matter to understand this kind of things. Well, here you clearly see that, as we said before, KT will be important. Why is KT important? Because if KT is equal to, I mean, if there is no thermal agitation, well, if without any thermal agitation, what we will have is simply that all the ions will condense. And then, well, the minus will attract the plus will attract the minus. And my drawing is really nasty. Which is, we'll have a perfect ion condensation if T tends to zero. And of course, I mean, since we are dealing with an electrolyte, well, before of that, we could have a problem with the condensation of the liquid. But if we assume that we neglect the condensation of the liquid, well, we'll have a problem with the condensation of the ions. So here it's an electrolyte. Well, based on that, we can define several length scales which are really important in the description of this kind of problem. So I'm not sure about your background, so maybe I should ask you, do you know about this kind of, I mean, do you know about the length scales involved in this problem? Alors, some of you have probably already discussed that when they were, I mean, younger, but what are your souvenirs of this kind of problems, just for me to know how fast I should go at this point? Any souvenir of that? No? Okay, that's okay. It just tells me that I shouldn't go too fast. So, okay. Well, so let's define all the lengths in this problem. So we'll take our time, and we may, which means that mainly today probably we won't be able to really make a calculation, a full calculation, and we make the calculation next time. But it's really okay. So the first length in the problem is what it calls the Bierum length. Well, what is the Bierum length? Is the length where, well, if we take two ions, at a distance of R, they attract each other. So there is a potential of the order minus E squared divided by 4 pi epsilon naught R. Well, here, I will take into account the fact that we are in water. So I will write epsilon R, where epsilon is equal to epsilon naught epsilon R, with epsilon R more or less 40 for water. So, well, without any thermal fluctuation, the ions will attract each other, but there is a length scale, which is called the Bierum length, where the order of magnitude of V is kT. And this length scale is given by E squared divided by this, which defined the Bierum length, and this will be of the order of kT. So LB is defined as E squared divided by 4 pi epsilon kT. So of course we can calculate these, and I give you the results for water. So this is 7 angstrom for water. Well, is that big or is that low? What kind of distance should we compare these to know if it's small or big? Yeah. So we can calculate exactly. This would be compared to the intermolecular distance. And if we say that C0 is the concentration in moles per liter, we can say that C naught will be 10 to the minus 3 divided by Na times rho, the concentration now in ion per meter square. I just give you all the calculation, and then the average distance d0 will be related to that, and it will be 1 over r0 to the power 1/3. So by changing the concentration, we can calculate the average intermolecular distance. And as an example, I calculated for 1 millimolar. And in this situation, the distance d0 is of the order of 12 nanometers, which is much larger than the Birum length. And this means, sorry, and this clearly means that in average, if we deal with, I mean, concentrations like that, we will be able to consider that the thermal agitation is big enough in order to separate the ions. Well, I should just notice that there should be a problem. Here, I've mainly dealt with monovalent ions, but if we are dealing with polyvalent ions, then if the Birum length defined for an ion of let's say, I don't know, EZ plus, the Birum length will be Z square times the one we have calculated before. And if we deal with an ion like aluminium plus, as an example, then the Birum length for could be could reach something like 7 nanometers, for concentration which will be of the order of the molecular distance, which means that for the polyvalent ions, the description of ions which are dispersed in the solution can be false. So we won't deal with that. And to be completely honest, there has been a huge effort at the beginning of the 2000 years to deal into account this effect of correlations between the ions. And I want to stay with the classical uncorrelated description of the ions. So there is another length scale. That is important in this kind of situation. and it's a double length. And do you have any idea? Do you already heard about that? Okay. Did any of you already heard about the double length? Maybe a little bit with David Kéré, but did you calculate it more than that? So there are two ways of thinking. Maybe I should do it like that. I will define the double length. I will give it to you. So the double length is epsilon kt divided by 2 n0 e square. No. Two over zero e square to the power 1/2. And again, epsilon is the permittivity and r zero is the number of ions in meter square. So this is the double length. I let you 1 minute and I let you think about it. I come back in 1 minute. I let you think about what does that mean. I come back. Sorry. Yeah, Lila, the length for which the thermal fluctuations become stronger than the electrostatic interactions. But this looks more or less like the Bjerum length, doesn't it? A ratio between thermal interaction and dipolar interaction? Well, not clearly. I'm not sure to understand your point. Well, let's try something else. It's not that easy. I let you think about it later, but what I would imagine is that let's imagine that we have created a fluctuation where to some point we have It's a thermal screening distance, but it's not that easy to. I mean, I would say that we will see later how it becomes a screening distance. But I mean, seen like that, it's not easy for me to justify that it's a screening distance. And let's imagine that we have created a fluctuation of charge. So we have created a kind of a zone where we have put all the negatively charged, and in front of that. We have another charge. So if we do something, so here we have a fluctuation where we assemble some charges. So here we can calculate the electrostatic energy associated to this situation. The electrostatic will be roughly the density of charge times the size of this sphere divided by 4 pi epsilon r times e square. And these will be of the order of kT for R equal to the Debye length. Okay, so this is exactly what is the Debye length is. It is the length scale over which it would not be possible to separate the negative charge to the positive charge. Well, of course, we can calculate the Debye length for several concentration, and I've calculated here, I have some data. Yeah, so for C naught is equal to 10 to the minus 3 mol per liter, the Debye length will be of the order of 10 nanometers. For C naught, the Debye length will be of the order of 100 nanometers. And so I think that this order of magnitude should be useful. And there is also something funny that for pure water, you can define the Debye length. Due to the fact that there are always ions. And the product of the anions and cations verifies these equations, and for these, the Debye length will be of the order of 1 micrometer. So it gives the order of magnitude of these lengths.
I'm sorry.
Yes.
Could you explain again How you see from the formula that it's the length scales over which we cannot separate plus and minus charges?
Yeah. So mainly, do you agree with this calculation?
Mm-hmm.
So here I just say that, well, if I create a system where I've assembled all the negatively charged in a sphere of radius r, and they interact with the positively charged, what is the size of this concentration fluctuation that can be destroyed by the thermal agitation? It is lambda d, which means that if I look at scales which are larger than lambda d, well, the charge concentration should be homogeneous. There shouldn't be charge fluctuation. But if I look in the system at lengths which are smaller than the Debye length, there could be some zone where, in average, there is a negative concentration which is higher than the positive concentration, or the reverse.
Okay, I think I see.
To say it a little bit, to write it, I would say that for d larger than the Debye length, we should have the electronegativity. And for d smaller than the Debye length, there could be locally some breakdowns of the electronegativity. Which means that we can concentrate the negative charge in one area
But what does this have to do with electronegativity?
Well, if I do something like in this situation where I have put all the negative ions in a sphere, and I reject the positive ions outside of the sphere, you see that in this region, there is a global charge.
Yes, but I mean...
And then in this region, there is no electronegativity.
Don't you mean electron neutrality?
Oh, yes. Pardon. Sorry for that. It is just because... Thanks. I apologize. Electroneutrality. And of course, it has a lot of consequences because, a lot of assumptions of physics is based on the physics of electrolytes is based on the fact that we assume that there is some electroneutrality, and if we look at length scales which are smaller than that, and you see 100 nanometer that's small but it's not ultra small, then we could have some funny electrostatic effect to take into account, and it's exactly the point of the kind of calculation that I wanted to do with you today and the day after. Thanks. So
okay.
We can.
Thanks.
And we can define some other length scales. So there are a lot of them, and I want to let you be able to read the publication regarding electrostatic effects in the scientific literature. And there is another length which is called the Degree-Chapman length. So this is more related. Up to now, the charge concentration was not taken. The surface concentration, was not taken into account. But the degree Chapman length is really related to what happens close to the surface. And let's define this, that I write LG, and the GUI Chapman length is defined like 2KT epsilon divided by sigma E. So then again, same game. What does that represent? Any guess? Yeah, and Melissa, that's perfect. Entropy versus interaction with electric field created by sigma, you're right, because here, if we have sigma, it means that we have an electric field E, which is sigma over epsilon times NE, so which means that the force acting on an ion will be EE, so it will be E sigma over epsilon, and I will remove the vectors. So the force acting on a charge close to the surface is of this order of magnitude. So the work that we can define like that is the force times the GUI length is equal to KT. Which means that the GUI length is the length over which the thermal fluctuations will be able to detach a charge from the surface. And well, LG is of the order of 1 nanometer. For silica surfaces that we have with the density of charge that we have calculated before. What is the meaning of NX is just NX is a normal vector. Sorry. Okay. And finally, there is another length scale that we can calculate, which is the Dukin length. And that I will write, sorry. And the Dukin length is divided by sigma over E divided by rho zero. sorry for that. I will cut a microphone. I will make someone mute because. No, I cannot mute him. Why? Pourquoi je peux pas? I cannot get the way. Well, we'll see how it works. I don't know with Apollon 01. So what does that, sorry, what does that represent? Well, more or less it represents, I mean, it compares, I mean, it compares the distance between charge at the surface and the distance between charge at, I mean, it's not a ratio of distance, but it is the distance over which the average distance between the ions in the solution is equal to the average distance between the charges at the surface. Okay, but this one I want to use it that much, and to be honest, you see that all these show that since they have a lot of length scales, the problem of electrostatic close to a surface can be really complicated. And it, and it has been mainly studied in the 40s, so it's it came just a little bit after the quantum mechanics, and the name of the people who work on that were Verwey from over the guy from the and von oops. It was Verwey and von Verbeck who solved the problem. So well, and now we have to deal with the problem is that, well, we want to study the charge distribution close to the surface. Well, so that I think that some of you indeed have already seen, but I will do that at least slowly, and in the 10 minutes that are still available for me, I just want to go up to the equation that we will solve next time. So the hypothesis is that, well, we will work with monovalent ions. So they have only a charge plus and a charge minus. What we will assume is that we can neglect the solvent, as we have done before. So the solvent can be simply seen as a medium with a dielectric permittivity epsilon. And Well, you know, from you have probably have some souvenir of chemistry where you know that it's not that true. I mean, if you have an ion, it can strongly interact with a solvent. So here we completely coarse grain the solvent. Well, it's not modified. I mean, there is no modification of the local polarizability close to an ion. We can only consider that it has a very it can be completely described with a dielectric permittivity epsilon. Well, so whereas the first assumption is, I mean, it's valid. We can, in some cases, we can deal with monovalent ions. The second hypothesis of the coarse graining is more, I mean, could be discussed a little bit more, but we'll see that, I mean, it works more or less. So then, what we'll have to do is that we'll have to, in order to find the charge distribution close to a surface. So we are dealing with the ions where, again, rho zero is a bulk concentration of ions. And what I want to calculate is rho plus and rho minus with respect to Z, the concentration of ions relative to the surface when we have a charge concentration sigma at the interface. So in order to calculate that, we will use two equations. The first equation that we will use is the Poisson equation of electrostatic. And if we calculate the Poisson equation of electrostatic, it's simply that the Laplacian of the potential in any place of the solution is rho divided by epsilon. A rho is the total density of charge. So if we want to make rho plus and rho minus appearing in this equation, we'll have there is a minus here. Sorry. We'll have to say that delta V will be simply minus rho plus times E minus rho minus times E divided by epsilon. So that's the first equation we have to deal with. Well, are you all okay with this equation, with the Poisson equation? Do you? Yes. I wanted to see some things. Yes. Good. So if you all agree with that, now we need to write another equation. Arg. Is that we have to assume the Boltzmann distribution for the ions. which means that we'll do exactly as we have said. We will take into account the thermal fluctuation on the ions. So if we do that, as an example, we'll say that the density of rho plus is rho zero times exponential of minus EV divided by KT. Whereas rho minus is simply rho zero exponential of plus EV divided by KT. And of course, we say that, well, you see that V equals zero for V tends to infinity, and then rho plus is equal to rho minus and is equal to the bulk density. Okay, so now we have all these equations, and we can probably write an adimensional terms, which is EV over KT, and this quantity is called the Boltzmann potential, and it's simply the electrostatic potential adimensionized by KT. Okay, so now that we have these, we can combine all these the two equations. So I will say that delta phi, well, I will write it in two times. I will say that delta V is equal to minus E over epsilon rho zero times exponential minus pi minus exponential plus phi. Okay. And if I change a little bit by using this definition, trust me, you will get delta phi is equal to 1 over lambda d square sinus hyperbolic of phi. That should work. And at least that's homogeneous. So here we have a nonlinear equations, and before solving it, we need some boundary condition, and we will. We will just write this today, and we'll stop over that. So how can we get the boundary conditions? Do you have any idea? So here what we want to calculate at the end is, well, from that we can maybe find phi of z if we get the boundary conditions. And here in these problems, what we impose is sigma. So we need a condition for sigma. We need something which relates phi and sigma at the boundary condition. So the way we will do that is that we will say that the electric field at the surface is simply sigma over epsilon and is simply dV over dz in z equal to zero. Well, here we can you can change by multiplying these by e, sorry, by e over kt, by e over kt, and at the end you see that you will get something like d phi over dz calculated in z equal to zero, and z is related to something we have defined before, and it's the GUI length. So it is minus 2 divided by R. The GUI length. Okay, so from that we have one differential equation, one boundary condition. So we can solve it. Sorry. And I think that I have to stop here, and it will be what we will do for next time. And next time, the menu, just to tell you a little bit more about, yes, sorry. But yes, Lila, but the other boundary condition is that phi tends to zero when z tends to infinity. The other one is more trivial. But you're right. So what will we do next time? The next time we will basically solve in one case in a linearized regime. We will discuss the nonlinear case, and of course what we would like to do is calculate the force, as we have said before. And since I love experiment, I will discuss also how can we measure that. So this will be the end of lecture 2, and in lecture 3 we will begin to discuss. So here we will have discussed the force created by the charge concentration close to a surface, and in the lecture 3 we will discuss some other kind of fluctuations. Will be the fluctuations of interfaces, and it will be the main question of that. So we will still go on discussing what is the effect of K